isn't based on what I've done. Jesus, let your love take over me.
Water. Sing the praises of testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify and by Jesus Christ the righteous.
Yes, he is. This morning, just about the promise, the faithfulness of God.
Jesus, I am willing, even if it's not the way I planned. I want what you want. Lay down my opinions and offer every part of me again. I want what you want. I just want what you want. I don't need all the answers. I've never been more sure. You're in it all, Lord of it all, and I will stay surrendered, even when it feels uncomfortable. You're in it all, Lord of it all. Still standing. You're still standing. still standing. You're still speaking.
Today, we surrender up that control to you, Lord. May you be moving in us. May you be opening our ears, opening up our hearts to what we're about to receive and hear today. Lord, may we be able to take that and bless those in our community, bless our families, our friends. And it's in your name that we thank you for this day. And we thank you for all things. Amen. Church, you may be seated.
I had coffee this morning, and the dairy always makes me get a little coffee. That's a joke. Anyway, good morning. I'm Caleb. I'm with the New Here team, and it's good to welcome you. And if you are new here, I would love to meet you outside at the desk, say hello, give you a little gift as a thank you for joining us today, and give you any information that you might be looking for about our church or how to get involved, anything like that. It'd be great to meet you. Now, I know that it's actually written into the rules of morning announcements for church on Super Bowl Sunday that I have to mention it. So today's a big game. We can move on from that now. That's all I need to say. We also have a prayer line. If you are looking for any type of prayer, whether that's a celebration or a concern or a need, please send a text to 717-468-7353. 428. I was so close. I almost had that number down. 428-7353 if you have any prayer requests or concerns. We are going to also get into a video of an upcoming event put on by my dear friend and colleague at Messiah University, Marcel Giovanetti, who is at the Dillsburg campus. And she's going to go into a little bit more detail about what we're going to be featuring at our church in the upcoming weeks.
Professor at Messiah University in the graduate counseling program, and I'm also the owner of Courageous Hope Counseling, which is the private practice that I own. I've been in the field of mental health and substance use disorders as a clinician for quite a while, and today I'm here to talk to you a little bit about mental health during COVID. COVID has really exacerbated a lot of what folks have been dealing with in terms of mental health. And in it hasn't helped that we have also been social distanced from our communities of support, our churches, our families, our friends, our gathering spaces that have often mitigated some of the effects of those things that we might feel. But COVID has left us feeling more isolated, more disconnected, and yet we have more that we're exposed to in terms of pain and suffering. So if you're sitting in the audience today and thinking, wow, I really do know someone who struggles, or I struggle myself and I really don't know what to do, this might be an event for you. This would be a great place for you to come and ask questions, to find out how the mental health system works and how you can access care, but also to learn about maybe some things you could do to cope, and how to navigate the mental health system so you can get the help that you need. If you can't identify someone in particular or yourself, I think this could still be a helpful event for you to attend, because you know we are called to support each other and love each other and be the bearers of hope and healing for each other. And sometimes just being culturally informed about mental health can help you be the right support at the right time for the person, and you could actually save a life. So I really do hope that you will attend. I hope that you will come. I'm looking forward to this. I'm really passionate about advocacy around mental health issues. And so I'm hoping that this could be a place where not only you find resources, but you can also learn. So come out and join us at the end of the month, and we look forward to seeing you.
Coming up on Saturday, September 26th at the Dillsburg campus at 6 p.m. Marcelle is an amazing speaker. She's an amazing speaker, and I think it's well worth your time. As someone who was not at their best during seasons in the past couple years because of COVID, I strongly encourage you to let you know that you're not alone in this. And if that does kind of just spark any interest or thoughts about yourself or a loved one, I really encourage you to seek out that event, and Marcel's really going to deliver some powerful words and resources and supports. If you would like to give to the offering, the ways you can do that are on the back of the bulletin. There's an online, there's a texting option, and there is a there are boxes outside in the auditorium if you would like to give to the offering. And next, we're going to have the bumper for our new sermon series, Love and Light, and then we're going to hear from Zach.
Well, good morning. That's real loud. Real quick clarification. So the mental health thing is happening in February 26th, not September 26th. Caleb had too much coffee today. I'm Pastor Zach. I'm really excited to be with you this morning. And we're starting a new series. And if you were with us through the last series, we did this interactive prayer where there were motions and we all repeated. So I thought we'd do the same thing. So if everyone would do the motions with me of this new prayer, and I'm joking, okay? We're not doing that. But I am excited about this series. We're looking at the letter of 1 John, and there is so much packed in these, like, five pages. And so for us to take the next few weeks and look at it, but I wanted to start a little bit with giving a little bit of background to it. Like, why are we reading? Who's writing 1 John? Who is he writing to? And, like, I'm a Bible nerd where it's like, man, cultural context, like, I get excited about that stuff. And it's like learning about, like, this group of dissenters that were leaving the church. And it's like, this doesn't really matter to us right now, but it's so exciting. So I'm not going to go, like, down that long rabbit trail. But I think it's important for us to remember that John was a real person. That when we read these words, that it was somebody writing a letter to people that he loved. Because so often we can read the Bible as if it's just like a textbook. Or we read the Bible in the tone of voice that we talk to ourselves in. Like, you know that tone of voice when you screw something up. I can't tell you how many times I'm doing something and it's just like, come on, Zach. And I feel like so often when I read scripture, like, that's how God talks to me. Come on, Zach. You know better than that. And I remember sitting in a class one time and the professor read the entire book of James to us. And he's a hospital chaplain. He'd been doing it for years and he just had a heart that loved people. And he read the book of James and we sat there and he said, so what stood out? And almost everybody in the class said, I never heard it that way before. It almost sounded like you loved us and wanted the best for us. And he's like, if we could just start to imagine that the God who created everything, the God that created humanity because he loved humanity, that he still loves humanity, if we could start to imagine that, like, him working in humanity and through history because he loves people, that the person who's writing these letters, like, God loved them, And the person writing the letter loved the people he was writing to. And the same spirit who was speaking to that author, who was speaking to those recipients, is the same spirit that's speaking to us. And that the same God who loved them loves us. Like, that changes how we read scripture. And I get it. Sometimes I'm dense and I need somebody, like, very clearly to be like, you're an idiot, knock it off. But I don't see Jesus doing that very often. There are times, don't get me wrong, there are times where Jesus, I imagine, like, just going, okay, again, love your enemies. Like, I didn't think I had to say that one again, but okay. So there are times where, like, yeah, we need to hear blunt things. But if we could default to God wants to speak to us in love, I think it's going to change how we read this. Now, I don't know if you know me too well. I don't like things staying the same for very long. And so, like, I will just randomly change things. So, like, in my office, it was just like, okay, desk going over here, couch moving over here. Like, we're just going to move things around. I've been here not quite 3 years. I've rearranged my office, like, 9 times. And even changed the room. Like, I moved from this office to this office. And so, sometimes, especially in Sunday mornings with church, like, it can feel like, oh, it's the same thing, it's the same thing. And so I wanted to change it up a little bit, but instead of changing, like, here's a new, fresh way of doing things, I wanted to go back to, like, 2,000 years ago on how some things were done. And so when John wrote this letter to the church, they wouldn't just read the first part of it and go, okay, we'll get to the rest of it next week. Like, how many of you remember getting a love letter? I do. And I never opened it and read the first paragraph and went, okay, I'll save the rest for later. No, you read it. And then you read it again. And then you, like, put it away and you went back to it, like, 15 minutes later. And if you were weird and it was like, they sprayed perfume on this. Like, you know what I mean? But we never read letters, like, one paragraph at a time over the course of a month. So I'm going to read all of 1 John to us this morning. Now, that may sound like a lot. It's like 4 pages. So it'll be okay. I time myself. We won't be here all day. So here we go. If you have your Bible, follow along. We don't have it on the screen because that would be, like, way too many slides. So 1 John chapter 1, verse 1. We're going from start to finish. Remember, John, this is the Apostle John who was with Jesus. Like, he walked with Jesus. He talked with Jesus. Jesus told him he was his own. That's a hymn joke for the sanctuary. I got you. Anyway, this was the John who at the Last Supper, it said that he leaned against Jesus. Like, imagine, like, this guy was there. Like, he was that close to Jesus. When Jesus died and was buried and rose from the grave, John was the one run into the tomb. And he just had to make sure in his gospel that he let everybody know he was faster than Peter. But like, he was there. He was first. This is the guy who's writing to us today. So he says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we've heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the truth as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Beloved, I am writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I'm writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. I am writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I am writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I write to you, children, because you know the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. Children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard, the Antichrist is coming. So now many Antichrists have come. Therefore, we know that it is the last hour. That they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us. But you have been anointed by the Holy One, and you all have knowledge. I write to you not because you do not know the truth, but because you know it, and because no lie is of the truth. Who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. Let what you heard from the beginning abide in you. If what you heard from the beginning abides in you, then you too will abide in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he made to us, eternal life. I write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you, but the anointing that you received from him abides in you, and you have no need that anyone should teach you, but as his anointing teaches you about everything and is true and is no lie, just as it has taught you, abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink from him in shame at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness has been born of him. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children. We are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, and he as he is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. John just had to throw a little rhyme in there. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. By this it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not be surprised, brothers, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Whoever does not love abides in death. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. By this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our hearts before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God, and whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in us, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh and is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and now is in the world already. Little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are from the world, therefore they speak from the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God. Whoever knows God listens to us. Whoever is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. because as he is also, as he is, so also are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother, whom he has, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome, for everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood. And these three agree. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God, that he has been born concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe in God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne according or concerning his Son. And this is the testimony that God gave us, eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you. Believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of him. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask, and God will give him life to those who commit sins that do not lead to death. There is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death. If we know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. We did it. Thanks for hanging in there with me, okay? Now, there's a few things that we need to point out here. One, John kind of talks like a dad. What I mean by that is that dads are very black and white. This is right, this is wrong. Do this, don't do this. And he draws like these comparisons, right? So we have this list of comparisons. He goes, there's light and darkness. If you're in God, you're in the light, but if you're not, then you're in the darkness. If you love God, then you have to love other people, but if you hate other people, then you don't love God. This is how we know truth, this is how we know lies. People who do righteousness or are righteous and people who do evil. And there's this difference between what it means to be a child of God and a child of the world. And so John is constantly drawing these two things. Now, he's doing that to make a point. Some of us read this, and granted, if you didn't fall asleep somewhere around chapter 3, thanks for hanging in there. But like sometimes we heard things that he said and we went, what the heck does that mean? Like there's some sin that leads to death, but there's some sin that doesn't lead to death. And what we'll do is like we'll get hung up on this one little thing and we'll forget everything else that he's saying. So some of this, you know, that cultural context that I get all geeked about, like some of it's important. So John may be addressing certain things that are happening within the church he's writing to. But there's a tremendous amount of things that apply to us. That what we just did of hearing the word of God preached, and not just preached, but just read aloud. Like, since God was making his people, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God that brought them out of Egypt, there were countless times where the God of David, where all these kings, and God said, bring the people together and read the law to them. Read my word to them. And that's what we did. We brought the people of God together and we read his word. And so we go, what do we do with this? Because John has like three main points that we saw kind of repeated. And let's be honest, John did repeat himself a lot, sometimes in the same sentence, right? It's like if you abide in him and him in you and then you abide and then we're all together. And it's just like, okay, I think we're all together, right? Maybe something like that. So here are the three main themes of 1 John. He was really, really insistent on the incarnation of Jesus. He kept bringing up love for brothers and sisters, and he kept bringing up this relationship between sin and being God's children. So let's start with a few things, because, again, going back to if we could hear this as, like, God loves us. Like, how many times did he call them beloved? When's the last time you've been called beloved? Like, we hear that, and we hear that Jesus loves you, right? And it's like, Jesus loves me, and, you know, this I know kind of thing. We go back to, like, yeah, God loves me, God loves me. But, like, do we really believe that? Because so often, like, our relationship with God is a codependent relationship. Where the things that we do, the ways that we pray to him, the things that we ask for, is all just an attempt to not make him mad. Or because we're afraid of him. Because if I don't go to church, if I don't tithe, then, I mean, he's going to take away the stuff that I have. If I don't do these things, then somebody I love is going to get sick. And we have this codependent relationship with God that we don't actually, like, come to him acknowledging the love he has for us. It's just about keeping him happy. Like, because when God's happy, then good things happen for us. But when God's not happy, that's when all the problems happen. And we experience this where, like, the reverse, where something bad is happening and we think, oh, I must have done something wrong and God's mad at me. No, sometimes bad things happen. And the thing is, like, the psalmist says, like, God's close to the brokenhearted, that in those moments, God's like, I'm here. I'm still walking with you through this. I didn't do this, but I'm going to help you get through it. And so what happens is John is talking about Jesus. Like, if we can remember Jesus, you know, Jesus who left heaven to come to earth because he loves us. The Jesus that was everything about God and everything about humanity, and he was right here with us, that he was Emmanuel, God with us. Man, that takes love. There are moments in my life where I volunteered to do something, and it's like, this is going to take an hour, and it's like, ugh, I don't even want to be here right now. And Jesus left heaven to come to earth to live an entire life, to be crucified. And I can't do an hour of, like, not even that hard of things. And John's going, remember Jesus. We look at Jesus. We talk about loving brothers and sisters. Why? Because we see Jesus doing that. We're just copying Jesus. Like, John even says, like, this isn't even new. I'm not writing a new thing. You've heard this command, which is why I kind of just wanted to read the letter, because it's not even like, hey, here's a new sermon from Pastor Zach. Like, I just took John's sermon. And this idea of being a child of God and sinning, and we go like, man, that's so hard to, like, so we're just not supposed to sin? John's laying that out, like, children of God don't sin. And so then we can, you know, do the logical conclusion of, like, if I've sinned, then I guess I'm not a child of God. And he's going, no, like, there's this habitual attitude that somehow sin doesn't matter. That the things that we're told are sin, the things that we're told, like, hey, this is actually against what God wants for your life. This is actually against his character. Stop doing those things. And we go, like, ah, it's not that big of a deal. You know how I know? Because I did it again and nothing happened. Right? Like, I've sinned and nobody died. I sinned and I didn't, like, was struck down with a lightning bolt or a disease. So it's like, it must not be that bad. We talk about the wages of sin is death, but, like, I'm still standing. And so it's like, really, like, the children of God don't sin? And it's like, well, if we get back to this idea of love, like, why would I want to intentionally do something that hurts somebody that I love? Brennan Manning says this in his book, Ruthless Trust. This is towards the end, and he uses this example of a woman who was cheating on her husband, who then blamed her husband for the affair, and then went to a counselor about it, and the counselor pointed out things in her life, and so then she started blaming the counselor for the way things were in her life. And so Brennan says, in a world where the only plea is not guilty, what possibility is there of an honest encounter with Jesus who died for our sins? We can only pretend that we're sinners and thus only pretend that we're forgiven. I think this is where we live the majority of times. That we talk about, yeah, I know that God loves me, but it's just when we're around other people, like at church. And so we think that our sin doesn't really affect us. We think that our sin doesn't really affect our relationship with God, but so we just pretend. Yeah, I know that's bad, so I have to pretend that, okay, God, I need the forgiveness. And we just live in this life of pretending. John is calling us to love God. Like, that's what he's getting back to. Love God. And this is what it looks like. It involves action, and it involves other people. It doesn't just involve, like, just make sure you're reading your Bible every morning for 10 minutes or praying for 10 minutes. I know I've shared this before. Like, that feels like you going up to your best friend or your best friend coming up to you and going, like, hey, what's the least amount of time that I have to spend with you in order for us to be friends? Like, none of us would like that, but we go like, oh, what's the least amount of time I have to actually talk to God in order for us to have a relationship? And so we say, oh, just, you know, 15 minutes kind of thing. But if it's love, wouldn't you want to be with that person? And we have to understand, like, this whole idea of, like, doing commandments and keeping commandments, like, our relationship with God is not an equal relationship like we have with other people. Like, he is superior. He is bigger. He is better. And so when we look at things like, well, it says if we love him, we have to do commandments. But, like, that doesn't work in friendships like this, right? Like, with you and me. Like, that sounds almost like a middle school girl. Like, if you love me, you'll do what I say. And it's just like, nope, that's not healthy. But it is healthy when it's a supreme benevolent God who loves us, where he's going, if you just listened, if you just tried this, if you just did these things. So here's what we need to do. We need to start doing something. For the last 2 years, and I'm not trying to negate what we've gone through, what you've gone through, but for the last 2 years, it's become really evident that it's easy to be a part of church and not do things. It's been real easy to be a part of church and actually not even come to church. So we need to start doing something. And I know, like, there's already people in the room, watching online, wherever, who's making the reasons and the excuses for why it doesn't work. You don't know, Zach. And yeah, I get it. For the legitimate reasons of, like, health, I get it. But those people are usually not the ones who are arguing. It's the people who just don't want to give up comfort. It's the people that realize, like, oh, actually just focusing on me feels real, real good, real nice. We go, yeah, that's called selfishness. Like, I think it's time that we get off our butts and start doing something. Like, there is a world, there is a community that desperately needs Jesus. And we think that we're loving them by being away from them. But by not sharing the truth that Jesus actually said, like, hey, here are things that are good for you. And we go, well, we don't want to step on toes. And we, you know, we're all about peace. And it's like, no, that's not peace. That's just, like, abandoning them. So I want to quote one of our worship leaders who was subbing at a high school. This is what she said to a girl in a gym class. She said, sometimes starting is the hardest part of something. That's Christian Mercado in a high school gym class. And she just said, like, sometimes starting is the hardest thing. Just go do it. And the girl went, oh, okay, and got up and did it, like, mind-boggling. That is, like, I just had to be that clear and straightforward. Like, not even, like, that. I mean, I guess that could be in a fortune cookie, but, like, we just need to start something. I know I'm going over time a little bit, but, like, here are the two things that I want us to realize, that loving God requires action, and loving God requires others. Okay, like, John was getting at us, saying, like, look, loving God, if we think about this idea of light, like, light reflects and refracts, like, the love that we have for God has to involve other people. If you love God, then you will love other people. Like, it's a byproduct. It has to happen. Because if you're not loving other people, then we can look and go, I don't know if you really love God, because that God loved people enough that he left his comfort, left where he was to come be close to them, to suffer, to give up conveniences, to realize that people were going to call him wrong and stupid and that he didn't know and that he's going against culture and he shouldn't be doing these things. That God came to us and we see him and he loves us. And we go, if we want to be like him, that means we have to do the things that he did. And we have opportunities. Oh, my word, do we have opportunities for you to do something. Like, I know in just youth ministry, I need 3 more men to help me with youth ministry. Because right now we have a junior high boys small group of 18 junior high boys who need men to show them that God loves them and that they love them. And it's like pulling teeth to try to get people to help. Dillsburg needs 3 more men to start helping in the youth ministry. And I'm not trying to guilt trip you, but here's the deal. If we've been sitting on our butts for 2 years, like, you've been tripping, okay? Like, you need to get up and start doing something. Our kids ministry, like, if we go like, oh, they're so precious, they're so important, but, like, we'll just leave them over there because this is for me. This is me time. We have opportunities because loving God requires loving other people. Now, I'm not like, please, please, please hear me. This is not like the guilt trip, like, see, we just need more volunteers in church. We just need to keep this machine running. No. James, in the letter of James, he says, this religion's worthless. If we're not loving widows, if we're not taking care of orphans, if we're not looking for people who need help, and if we have the means of doing it to help them. You have 2 hours on a Wednesday night. You have 2 hours on a Sunday night. You have an hour on a Sunday morning. Like, you have what they need. Can you smile at children? I mean, it may be kind of awkward if you haven't done it in a while. But could we start? Could we try? Could we realize that the love that we've been called into isn't just for us? That the love that God shows us has to be for other people. So let's start doing something, church. Jesus, you gave us so much this morning. And to think about our relationship with you, God, maybe we are scared of you. Maybe we're scared of you becoming angry. Maybe we're scared of punishment. Maybe we're scared that you're going to look on us with shame or disgust. And I pray that we would take a step into a healthy relationship where we recognize that we're loved, like real love, and that we can show that back to you. And by showing that back to you, we also love other people around us. God, there are so many people around us. Forgive us for putting blinders up. Forgive us for overlooking them. This is not a new commandment. You've been repeating yourself for 2,000 years and beyond that, that we need to love enemies, that we need to love brothers and sisters, that we need to love those around us because that's how you've loved us. God, if we help us stop pretending. Help us stop pretending that we don't need you. Help us be real and vulnerable this morning to start something, to do something, to show your love to this world. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand together as we close out our time, making a declaration that, yes, I will follow after you, God.
Count on one thing, the same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who never waits, working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. And yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Same God who never fails, never fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley.
For worshiping us with us today, church. Zach's message really made me think about the commandment that Jesus gives, love God and love your neighbor. And when the lawyer asked Jesus, who is my neighbor, Jesus replies with the story of the Good Samaritan. But when Zach talks about loving people today, I think about, you know, loving your neighbor. And if you were to ask the question, well, who is my neighbor, I give you here's a really practical response to that today. Not a parable, but who is your neighbor? Like, do you know your physical neighbor's names? That might be a practical way to start loving the world and loving your neighbor by learning their names, getting to know them, bringing them whatever your specialty is in cooking or handiwork. But love your neighbor this week in whatever the way you can do that, or any other practical way you can start loving people. And yeah, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Gonna come.